Our first scripture today will be from the book of John, chapter 19, verse 30a. When Jesus had received the wine, he said, "It is finished." Our second scripture reading today will be from the book of Luke, chapter 23, verses 45 through 47. While the sun's light failed, and the curtain of the temple was torn in two, then Jesus, crying with a loud voice, said, "Father, into your hands I commend my spirit." Having said this, he breathed his last. When the centurion saw what had taken place, he praised God and said, "Certainly this man was innocent." The word of God for the people of God.
I forgot to mention at the beginning of the service that the choir will be doing a very special Good Friday service this Friday at 7 p.m. Will that song be part of it?
No, actually, the tree.
But that one was beautiful. It's amazing. So please come hear more of that amazing music. Join me in prayer. God, as we share in this last message during our Lenten season, the last reminder of the last words of Jesus from the cross, we ask that you would open our hearts, our minds, our spirits, that you would speak to us today, that we may hear something that we have never heard before, and most importantly, be reminded of your deep love. May the words of my mouth, O Lord, and the meditation of my heart be pleasing to you, our rock and our Redeemer. Amen. So we're down to the last two statements that we hear from Jesus from the cross. We're down to the last few minutes of Jesus's life. And the first phrase that you heard Tanner read, the first words from the Gospel of John, I have always read it with a sense of life is ebbing away, as Jesus says it. I've always heard that with a sense of it is finished. But I never really paid attention to the fact, if you hear what Tanner said, it said that Jesus said it is finished in a loud voice. He shouted, some of the translations say. And so you have to wonder, what is it that this is getting at? What is it that this phrase is saying? And if you look in the Aramaic, which Jesus would have spoken Aramaic, and if you read it in the Greek, it actually would have been one word. In both the Aramaic and the Greek. And it would not have been a sound of defeat, but instead a sound of victory. It would have sounded something like this: complete, finished, done. I hear that differently, and I think differently about the profound meaning of this saying and this phrase when I hear it that way. And so we are to ask ourselves, what is it? What's the it that Jesus is referring to? Because when you hear it in that way, it's a sound of victory. It's a sound of completion, a project complete, a sense of satisfaction, if you will. So the question for us today is, what is the it? What was the mission that Jesus was on? What was the purpose that was fulfilled? And this is a really important question for us to wrestle with as followers of Jesus, because this is our defining story as we make our way to the story of resurrection next Sunday. As Jesus made his way in with the palm and the parade on Sunday, by Friday, we know he breathes his last. And this symbol of a cross is something that we use as our front and center, most critical symbol. So what does it mean? What does the cross mean? Leslie Weatherhead, a wonderful theologian in the 20th century, wrote a book called A Plain Man Looks at the Cross. And he says this in that book. He says, I cannot imagine any author, however great their scholarship or penetrating their spiritual insight, getting to the point where they feel they could so expound the message of the cross as to leave no question unanswered and nothing unexplained. And I appreciate this because if anybody says that there is one particular absolute message of the cross, they are sorely underestimating the profound power behind the cross. In fact, Jesus himself speaks of his death, his impending death, and the meaning of the cross 50 different times, just Jesus alone. That doesn't even make it to Paul and some of the other writers and how they explain the cross. He uses all kinds of metaphors. He talks about a seed coming out of the ground in the Gospel of John and coming back and sprouting in different ways. He refers to himself being lifted from the ground and people being drawn like a magnet to his story, to his death and resurrection. He refers to there's no greater love than a person laying down their life for a friend. In other words, this sacrificial love, and the one who's sacrificing, their heart breaks in the midst of that sacrifice. He's referred to the crucifixion as the Lamb of God taking away the sins of the world, that somehow on the cross, death is defeated. And then you make your way to the Apostle Paul, and the Apostle Paul refers to the death of Jesus as the Redeemer. And you have to remember back when you owed someone a debt, you may be imprisoned, and a family member would come and pay that debt. In the midst of that, you were called redeemed. And so here we have this story where we hear this metaphor that we are redeemed. In other places, he's known as a savior, a warrior. I could go on and on and on. And so it points to the fact that there is not one meaning or way to describe the cross. And the metaphors are not the thing itself. The metaphors are a way to try to get at the meaning. Take, for example, if I asked you, what is love? And I went around, you probably wouldn't just have one word. You might have to say, love is like, and you may describe it. And many of you would give so many different beautiful, profound answers. Or what is beauty? The reality is the cross is less science and more poetry. The cross is less of a mathematical equation and more a profound poem poured out, a love letter that God gives us today. Because, see, we need different things as followers of Jesus. Sometimes we need to know that we are redeemed. Sometimes in the midst of our pain and our suffering, we need to know how deep God's love is for us. So on the cross, we find our brokenness in God's grace. We find our need to be loved in God's love for us. We find a picture of how we are meant to live our lives. And everything we see in the world around us, we see in light of the cross. This is our defining story as we make our way to the resurrection. The last statement that Jesus says, "Into your hands I commit my spirit," is once again a reminder that Jesus often prayed the Psalms. This statement can be found in Psalm 31, verse 5. And so if he spoke verse 5, the question we are to ask ourselves is, what did he do with verse 1 through 4? Maybe he said it to himself and only could muster up the energy for that last verse. So I'd like you to hear 31, verse 1 through 5, and imagine Jesus saying these words.
In you, O Lord, I seek refuge. Do not let me ever be put to shame. In your righteousness, deliver me. Incline your ear to me. Rescue me speedily. Be a rock of refuge for me, a strong fortress to save me. You are indeed my rock and my fortress. For your name's sake, lead me and guide me. Take me out of the net that is hidden for me, for you are my refuge. Into your hand I commit my spirit. You have redeemed me, O Lord, faithful God.
There it is. Once again, Jesus on the cross is teaching us how to pray. This fifth verse was known to be a verse that all Jewish children memorized. Just as our children sometimes learn the prayer, "Now I lay me down to sleep," or maybe there's another prayer that you teach them at a very young age, the Jewish children would go to bed every night and recite, "Into your hands I commit my spirit, O Lord." And so here Jesus is teaching us about prayer. That when we face darkness and despair, when we are facing the shadow of death, when we are facing the unknown, what do you pray? A prayer of trust. Into your hands I commit my spirit. And it's almost in a sense that Jesus is teaching us not only how to die, but how to live. When we are facing uncertainty, instead of worrying, if you've ever heard that saying that if you worry, it's like a rocking chair. If you keep rocking, it's going to continue to just sort of create a dents and holes. Instead of worrying, instead of being afraid, we turn to this prayer, this simple yet profound prayer of trust. Into your hands I commit my spirit. We wake up and we say, "Into your hands I commit my spirit." We make our way through our day because we do not know what each day will hold. And we simply offer that prayer. In a sense, Jesus is preparing us to live each day with this simple promise, not to be afraid, but to be prepared. Prepared to live each day with the promise that God is with us, that we are not alone, because we don't know when our last day will come. And so our task is to be ready. What does it mean to be ready? God, into your hands I commit my spirit. You are going to walk with me, and I am not alone, and I am not afraid. That is what Jesus is teaching us in his last moments of life. See, this is our darkest moment in the story of our faith. Yet somehow, I find great hope in knowing that into God's hands I commit my spirit. Amen.